Hello, everyone. I'm Oleksiy Goncharenko, a student at Dartmouth College. Thank you all for coming tonight. Today, we're hosting a special speaker, Oleksiy Goncharenko, a member of Ukrainian Parliament and Vice President of the PACE Delegation on Migration, Refugees, and Internally Displaced Persons. It's truly an honor to have you here, Mr. Goncharenko. Please join me in welcoming Oleksiy Goncharenko.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
The event is organized by the Eastern European Student Club and Future Via Humanitarian Nonprofit. The event is co-funded by COSO, Dartmouth Department of Government, and the John Sloan Dickey Center for International Understanding at Dartmouth. As part of introducing Oleksiy Goncharenko, we will show his video introduction.
I took with myself this flag.
I just want to remind you that at the beginning of this invasion, the world was giving Ukraine 2, 3, 4 days before we would fail under Russian attack. But as you see, in the second month, when we had not failed, but quite opposite, we are liberating our territories like in Kiev.
Я хочу звернутися до російських солдат. Добро пожаловать в ад!
And he wants to kill civilians, as many as possible. That's why he did it on Monday morning to do it. So I want to address all of you. How many more Ukrainians should die?
Putin is weaponizing everything. Food, energy, nuclear energy, nukes, everything. So I think that, first of all, we should make lessons from what has happened.
What is doing Putin? Putin is taking Russian Federation to Stalin's times.
Ich habe eine Frage, auf welche ich eine Antwort bekommen wollte. Ja oder nein? Ist Putin Mörder? Vielen Dank.
I think that it's very important for us, like a free world, to be united, not to argue one with another. What we should do with the world security system, United Nations doesn't work, and should Russia be excluded from the Security Council of United Nations? Thank you.
Fuck you, Lavrov.
Today, 21% of our territory is occupied, and we're speaking today about occupied territories. 21. It's like Austria and Switzerland together, or like state of Mississippi or Pennsylvania.
We won the Battle of Kiev, so our army knows what to do. We are prepared and we will fight. We're not only holding the ground, but we are ready to counterattack them.
No resolutions but weaponry. No speaking but weaponry. No debates but weaponry. Weaponry today to stop the evil. And after this, New Nuremberg. Thank you.
Yeah.
So right now, Mr. Goncharenko, we will show your presentation.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'm very honored that so many people came to listen. And thank you for interest to my country. Thank you for coming. And it is very important for me to explain and to address to American public, and especially in universities, and especially in so honored university as Dartmouth College, about what's going on in our country and why does it matter. But, you know, I wanted to start from another thing, but, and you see the name of my presentation, Live Free or Die. By the way, as I know, New Hampshire knows these words very good. And I think that's really what we will be speaking about now. But I think it is important, and we just met with one of your professors here in the Pine, and he said that he thinks it's important to American people to understand a little bit how life in Ukraine today looks like. And I decided that he's right. And I want to start by, not by the presentation itself, but quite differently with several seconds, but you will understand it. But before I will do it, I just want you to remind, how did you wake up this morning? Just for a second, how was it? this morning. Maybe yesterday was a party, I don't know, maybe something else. It could be. But then the morning you woke up. And I want to show you how millions of Ukrainians woke up more than 300 days. I think it's clear, it's an air raid signal attack, and every day for more than 300 days, millions of people, including to my kids who are now in Odessa together with my wife, they are waking up like this. And I think that's important to remember and to understand that what's going there, it's not like Chamberlain said many years ago in 1930s, he said, you know, that's a quarrel in faraway country between people of whom we don't know anything. That's not. I believe this is a crucial moment in the history of the first half of 21st century, because this is, and I want to ask you to go to the next our slide, this is the war of the free world against dictatorship. And that's why this is so important, what's going on in Ukraine. And from that will influence many things for years and decades ahead, and also things which are directly connected with the United States and how do you live. And you know, like Chamberlain, he said these words, and after this, London was waking up with this sound for many years, because at some moment they just underestimated the danger. And it looks for me that sometimes this danger, which is now coming from a dictatorship against the free world, is also underestimated. It's not only about Russia and Ukraine. The picture is much wider. But it happened that now the point, the crucial moment, the place in the world where it's happening and where the future for next decades will be decided is Ukraine. And I have good news for you, like it is said here. The free world is winning. That is very important because like an introduction you heard, and maybe you remember the first days of Russian invasion, many said that Ukraine would fail, that it will take just days for Russians to take Ukraine, Kiev, and or the whole our country. But not. It happened absolutely other way. And I want us to make a lessons from what had happened, and that's about we will speak today. Please go next slide. So, the question is, why in Ukraine? Why this has happened in Ukraine, and this war between dictatorship and free world so awfully, so terribly is happening in our country? It's all about money and power, nothing new. Because Ukraine is a very important country from many points of view. But for years, it was like Ukraine was overshadowed by Russia, and many people thought that Ukraine is part of Russia, or Ukraine is something between Poland and Russia. And what is this country? Many people just couldn't answer the question, where on the map is Ukraine? But Ukraine is the largest agro-industrial country in the world. You should know that together, Ukraine and the United States, we make from 30 to 60% of world agro-export. Today, the food is a vital, absolutely, like yesterday and will be tomorrow. And Ukraine is a vital part of food security. The largest airplane in the world was built in Ukraine, not in the United States, with all respect, but in our country. Technologies for production of supersonic plane engines, the largest transit capacity in Europe. Ukraine controls, controlling Ukraine, you control the Black Sea. And the Black Sea is vital. You can take it from history that from the times of ancient Greeks, Black Sea was the origin, it was a breadbasket of the civilized world. And now it's happening again. When Putin stopped and closed the Black Sea by his threats, and there was no Ukrainian maritime agricultural export for, it was like 5 months, but this time was enough to increase the world food prices significantly. They raised, like they peaked, And millions of people in the world suffered from this. In some places, like in the United States, they just felt inflation. They just saw the prices in supermarket. But in some places, like in Somalia or Eritrea or other places, people were starving, and some of them starving to death because of the food prices peaking, because of closing of the Black Sea. That's how it's important. The most developed IT industry in Europe, Ukraine is the source of IT specialists for the whole world, many of them working at outsource for American companies, but it is essential. And the strongest army on the European continent. And I should add, also Ukraine is almost 40 million people. And that is absolutely important for dictatorships. Because dictatorships, they have their own fuel. And the fuel of dictatorships are people. And that is something very, very unhuman. That is something very disturbing. But that's how it works. I just want to give you a small part of Russian Empire history. Russian Empire, the Russian Federation is still Russian Empire. It is just a new Russian Empire, then Soviet Union. It was Russian Empire 2.0. Now it's Russian Federation. It's Russian Empire 3.0. And just we will take last 20 years. In 2000, Russia finally suppressed Chechnya, which is a small, tiny part of North Caucasus. To do it, that was a small nation, 1 million population, and Russia killed 200,000 of them to suppress them. 20%, one from five, were killed by Russians just to suppress this territory. But after they did it, now in 20 years, at that time, unborn Chechen boys now are fighting in Ukraine against Ukraine. Then Russia in 2008, they occupied parts of Georgia, which is not a big country, also in North Caucasus region. And now they took parts of this Abkhazia and South Ossetia. And now boys from Abkhazia and South Ossetia, young men like you, are fighting in Ukraine, are dying in Ukraine, are killing Ukrainians. In 2014, Russia occupied Crimea and part of eastern Ukraine. And now they're taking people, young men like you, to fight against their own compatriots. And that's why they needed Ukraine, because this is 40 million people and many men, which should, in their idea, who should be taken to Russian army to attack Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, Romania, to finish with Georgia, and so on. That's how it works. That is the reality. That's why the name of this lecture is Live Free or Die. New Hampshire was very wise taking this as a motto, because that is absolute reality. If you are giving up your freedom, one day you will be taking your life. You or your children or your grandchildren. That's how it works, and that we should remember. Let's go ahead. So what is the lesson for the free world when we have such big threats? It's a really big threat what's going on. It's not only between Russia and Ukraine. It's in other parts of the planet. Many dictatorships, they're watching what's going on in Ukraine, what will be after, and they will make their decisions to attack or not to attack, to move ahead or not to move ahead. And the lessons of free world, I think there are three. It's dominating values, dominating the economy, and dominating the military potential. And that the third thing is also important. I know that, I was parliamentary PACE, which was said several times that I work in PACE. Maybe you don't know what is it. It's Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, which is situated in Strasbourg in France. And it was very interesting. I came to France for our session, and there was a public event, not a public, like a rally, like on the streets. People coming to the streets, were young people like you, with the slogans, demilitarize France, that France should be denuclearized, demilitarized, and so on. It sounds very good. If you don't want to have a war, don't have an army. The problem is that you can have no army, but Russia or other countries, they have. And they will definitely use it, that you don't have army, and they have. So, yes, with this idea, you will live very happily, but not long. So that's something we should remember. Military potential is essential. Let's go ahead. Values. They're clear. I will tell you nothing new. What are the values of the free world? Democracy and freedom, rule of law, human rights, market economy. That is that are the values which really make free world the free world and which make life in free world like it is. Why the free world is prosperous? Why free world has such great opportunities? Because of these values. Let's go ahead. And these values, they are also very practical. It's not just words. I just want to show you the Russian army and Ukrainian army. It's a small picture. And that is not the worst picture of Russian army. So military budget of Russian army is more than $60 billion. During the last 20 years, Putin spent to Russian army more than $1,000 billion. $1,000 billion. And now in Russia, people are raising money to buy warm socks for their soldiers, which are mobilized and sent to Ukraine, because they don't have it. Because majority of this money is just stolen. This money are in yachts of Russian oligarchs. This money are in palaces of Putin. This money are everywhere, I don't know, in some casino, in some mansions in the United States, in some mansions in Florida, in California, but not in Russian army, fortunately for us this time. But that's how values work. Why it is important? Because only when you have democracy, when you have a rule of law, you can stop things like this. And Ukrainian army, with it, like, just for your understanding, in 20 years, they said more than $1,000 billion. Ukrainian army, we spent on our army during the last 20 years near $50 billion, in 20 times less. But our army is more, is better equipped today than Russian army. Let's go ahead. Economy. That is also very important, I think. We are saying the world is open and let us, free trade is important, and that is important. But you know, when I hear a lot about green energy, and I personally want to see the world being very environmental friendly. I want to see development of green energy. That is really important, climate change and other things. But I think we forget one of the points: what is a clean energy? I believe that clean energy is energy from clean countries. I mean, clean countries with a clean government with the same values. Because when Europe became dependent from Russian gas and oil, the result today is quite difficult. Germany, France, many other countries, they are suffering because they became so dependent from Russian energy sources, from Russian energy resources, from Russian fossil fuel, that today it's very difficult for them to survive. And that is one of the lessons we should remember. You can't count on the resources from dictatorships, because for them, everything is weaponry. They're weaponizing everything. Food, they're weaponizing food. Fossil fuel, they're weaponizing energy. They're weaponizing everything. So in their head, they will use this against you sooner or later. Next, we have the same experience in our country. There is country Belarus to the north of Ukraine, and now it is occupied by Russia in reality. And we were dependent from Belarus oil. And that is the lesson for all of us. I don't think that we did all right. I was one of those in Ukraine telling that we can't tolerate dictatorship. In Belarus there was dictatorship, and it still it is, but now they are in reality occupied. And I was telling for years in my country that we shouldn't count on this country. We shouldn't count on this dictatorship. We should fight with this. But I was said, oh no, this is a very good source for us to receive oil and oil products. And okay, this is dictatorship there, but really they don't intervene to our affairs. So let us be blind. And we were. And when the war started, the same moment the flow of oil and oil products from Belarus was stopped. the same second. So you can't rely on this. One more is United States of America and China. Their dependence from factories, from production and manufacturing, it can't be like everything is produced there. Because one day, you will just not receive it. And that's why I think free world should be self-sufficient. And that's, fortunately, it's a big, free world is big. And fortunately, and I believe in this, free world will expand. And I hope there will be a day when we will stay, maybe in some number of years, maybe here in Dartmouth, you will become, I saw these beautiful books you have, 1978, you will have a book 2026, and you will be in this book with your pictures. But you will come here and we will speak about free China, free Russia. That is possible. That is, I believe, the future of the world. But for the moment, it is not the case. And we should remember this. Let's go ahead. Military potential. It is really important. And I just want to give you one example. And United States of America can be proud of its weaponry and of its military potential. We received from the United States, I took two types of weaponry. HIMARS, and its multiple launch rocket systems, and Javelins. Javelins is anti-tank missile, man-handed. So they are both were developed in 1990s. And with this, we stopped Russian army. That was enough. Just imagine what we will do when we will finally receive planes from the United States, at least F-16, because that is a powerful weaponry we need. One more question I was asked in American media by American people. Why should we spend our money, American money, money of American taxpayers, to some faraway country? Why we should send to you these billions of dollars? We have a lot of problems here, and we will have what to do. That's why I think that it is very important to answer this question. And I want to tell you that I really believe, and I have evidences of this, that investment in Ukrainian army is the best investment in the United States history, or probably one of the best. Because by spending 3% of your military budget to Ukraine, we destroyed at least 50% of military capacity of your second biggest rival after China. 50%. And without losing no one American life, I think this is great investment. That is really great investment. And that's why we need to continue and to finish this, because it's so important for everybody, for all of us. Also, one more number for you. There was a poll recently asking American people, what is the biggest problem in the United States? What should we care about? And 35% told that is American economy. And then a number of other things, and 3% said, again, 3%, by the way, that it is a war in Ukraine. But I want to explain you why, in reality, American economy is dependent from the war in Ukraine. Because if you will take United States trade, even taking on the level of all states, including New Hampshire, who is the biggest trade partner of the United States of America? It's Europe. And even in all states, except, I think, of Iowa. Except of Iowa, all other 49 states, they are the number one trade partner is Europe. And what is the purpose of Putin and Russia? Is to disrupt Europe at all. He is not going to stop in Ukraine. He started Georgia, Moldova, and he wants to go ahead and ahead. It means if he wouldn't be stopped, millions of jobs of Americans, they will be under threat. Because Europe, as the biggest partner, as the biggest market for the American economy, just will be finished. Let's go ahead. That is one example of Ukrainian technologies, I can say. It's interesting that our country, in time of war, we are the first to make the sea drones, which attacked and destroyed part of Russian fleet, inside of their base. That's interesting. I think it shows the potential of our country and the potential of free people. Let's move ahead. The main goal, I just want us to understand that these, now we live in the world where free world coexists with the dictatorships. It will not be like this for very long. One of the forces will win. One of the forces will prevail. Because tyrants, they can't live normal life. They can't live like democratic governments live. They understand that they cannot coexist with free countries, because that is a permanent threat to them. So they will attack, as Russia showed in case of Ukraine, or many other possibilities are throughout the whole planet. And we should remember this, and we can't tolerate this. I made this parallel, like imagine cancer growing inside, not your, but somebody's body. Fortunately, this happens sometimes. And you can't live, and one part of this body, I know, brain, can't say, I don't care about liver. It's impossible, because everything is connected. And the whole body will die if the cancer will not be stopped. So the first step to living free, defeat Russia together. That will be a signal for the whole world that free world is stronger. That is also a chance for millions of Russians themselves. Because just imagine this country, which is the most, the richest country in the world from the point of view of sources. They have everything. Everything from chemistry, you can imagine they have in the ground. But they, for your understanding, near 10% of Russians today in 21st century, they don't have toilets in their houses. So they need to go outside. 10%. Just imagine this. The country is so rich, the country is so big, but they can't even give to their people a toilets. And they were robbing, when their army invaded Ukraine, they were robbing everything. Blenders, toilets. They were taking toilets from Ukrainian houses and flats to Russia. So it's absolutely unbelievable. So that's why the only way for Russians themselves to live normal life is to finally to become free country. Like, who benefited more from the denazification after Second World War than Germans themselves? Germany became one of the prosperous, wonderful countries respected in the world, but only after they came through denazification, when they stopped to be the cannon fodder for new crazy tyran. This is a signal to China, because China is watching what will be in Taiwan. And Taiwan, you know, is a semiconductors and other things. The whole world is connected. Changes the view of most dictatorship about the weakness of the free world. And you know what I'm speaking about. Because after Afghanistan, Putin decided, oh, they're weak. We can go. Because he felt that it's possible. Shows an attractiveness of our model of development to other people, to other nations, because they will clearly understand this is the system which works. These are the values which work. And that will be a very strong signal. And definitely that is something to prevent the world war. Because Putin is not going to stop. And those who are telling you, you know, now there are a lot of discussions and about, oh, there should be some peace. Maybe Ukraine should give some of its territories to Russia. Okay, maybe. I just want to explain you. You can't, if you have in the community maniac, you can't say, okay, let's give one woman to him. And like, okay, it happens. No, because in 1 month, he will want the second, then the third, then the fourth. It's hunger in their head. They can't stop. And tyrants absolutely are the same. This is a geopolitical maniacs. And you can't stop them just by giving them something, no. To do this, we need, as I told you, it's important for us to win today. And we, before in this presentation, when I was coming to you, there was also said tanks. Now we finally, there is a decision of the US government to give us tanks. Another story that we will receive them maybe in the end of the year. So it's not so good how it sounds, but still it is important decision and we are very thankful for it. But still we are waiting for some other weaponry. It is most of all we need, it's aircraft and long range missiles. They're called Atacms. I just want to tell you also a little bit personal thing. And the story about Ukrainian resilience is really important. It's a big story and the whole world is surprised that we stopped Russia and we will defeat Russia together with free world. I am absolutely sure about this. But part of this is and why values matter and what is the strength of free world? Strength of free world is our horizontal. Because Russia as a country, as a state, is vertical. There is empire and there are all others somewhere down and there is a chain. But we, United States of America, Ukraine, France, Germany today, other countries, we are horizontal. Because we are the source of the power. And that's why today in Ukraine, everybody are doing everything they can for our victory. That's why you can't, vertical can't defeat horizontal. That is also a very important lesson. And one of the examples that I have for this is the work of Goncharenko Centers. The network, this is the biggest non-governmental educational cultural network in Ukraine. We started before invasion, long before, as educational cultural centers where children and adults were learning English language free of charge. We are learning cybersecurity, financial literacy, and other things. After February 24, we also became volunteer centers. And just this one, this is the self-propelled howitzer, which is called Gvozdika. Gvozdika, I don't know how to translate it into... It's a flower, yes, but what exactly type of flower? It is. So, because in Soviet army, like Americans, you call your tanks by names of your generals. Abrams was general and so on and so on. In Russian, in Soviet army it was time, they called the tanks, the howitzers, by name of flowers. It's interesting, but we have different types of flowers. They look like this, you should know. And by the way, it's interesting that Russians, they were saying, their propaganda was telling, when Russian army will enter Ukraine, Ukrainians will meet us with their flowers in their hands. So this is the flower we are meeting them with. And this self-propelled howitzer was bought by our centers. Once again, ordinary people like you, like your parents or neighbors, starting from small children, because they were coming for us with their 1 hryvnia, it's our national currency, 10 hryvnia, it's like a half dollar, to say we want to raise money for our army to stop our enemy. And with this, we bought these anti-drone rifles, many other things. That was done just by our network. And this is just a small, the very small part of the great volunteer work which Ukrainian people made. That's why the free world is stronger. Because everybody is fighting, not for some emperor, but for him and herself. We know definitely what we are fighting for. We are fighting for our country, for our houses, for our children, because we want them to be free, because we want our country to be free, and we don't want for our country, the future, as I told you, to be in a cannon fodder for next tyrant. That's why we are stronger. That's why we will definitely win. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Goncharenko, for your amazing lecture. We're now opening Q&A sessions. So we are welcoming questions from the audience.
As students, is there anything we can do that helps support Ukraine or any things that we're not doing that would help the effort?
Thank you very much. Excellent question. First of all, it's very important just to spread. The main battle is always here. The main battle is for brains of people. And it's very important just to spread information, just to in social media, to share, to like, to speak with your parents, to speak with your friends, to tell them, you know, it's an important story. It matters for all of us. And that is the first thing. And I really, that is the most important. Secondly, definitely from this is coming the demand. We are in free country. And American politicians are doing what American people are waiting from them. If tomorrow American people will say, stop to send money overseas, that will happen. And that depends on you. To explain people why it is important. To speak with politicians, to speak with congressmen, assemblymen, city councilors, to tell them why it is important. Definitely, if you have an opportunity, you and your family, to donate, to help some humanitarian things, to help our network or any other network in Ukraine, that's up to you, but that is very important. Because here is one lady, hello, I want to introduce you, Lisa, right? Lisa, she raised in New Hampshire more than $2 million for Ukraine. And there are people like Lisa, a lot of in the free world. That is, again, the strength of free world. So if you can help by this, it's also very much appreciated. So there are a lot of ways how you can make your input in what's going on. And definitely, I want to tell you that after our victory, Ukraine will be a great place to come, to work, to invest, to rebuild, because that will be like a polygon. That will be a place to show all the best which free world has today. It should become like, what will be better signal to the world if the country which was invaded by dictatorship, awful dictatorship, which was feared by the world, first will stop it, then defeat it, and then we'll rebuild, and to show how free world is not only strong in military, but strong in their values and in their productive capacity. So you have a lot. I hope that somebody of you will come to Ukraine one day and will see our country by your own eyes. Thank you.
Thank you. On one of your slides, you mentioned victory over Russia. I was curious what that looked like. Does that refer to regime change or the cease of war? I was curious if you had some insight or what the current position of the government is on the matter.
Again, excellent question. So it's a lot of, it is discussed in the world and in different think tanks, in media, what is the victory and so on. But in reality, the question is simple. The victory of Ukraine is restoring of international law. It means restoring of our internationally accepted and recognized borders, and by the Russia itself. Some people are saying, oh, Russia, they felt that Ukraine should be part of it. It's not true in reality, because Russia by themselves accepted our borders, signed all agreements with us about our borders. And they were telling, we are your biggest friend. They were telling it for years. But we were suspicious, but it happened. So for me, it's clear that it is not just victory of Ukraine. The victory of the free world should be restoring of international law. Just criminal, which is Russia today under Putin, should be stopped and punished. The borders should be restored. The Russia should pay reparations because our country is devastated. That is the victory. And dot. We don't want any piece of Russian territory. Speaking about regime change in Russia, that is something which I believe is very important, but we will never fight for this. I don't think that we can and should go inside Russia, take Moscow, something like this. It's up to Russian people. We need to show that we are strong enough. We need to show what an awful thing was done by Russia, by Putin, and the people should understand this in Russia. And after this, they should change it themselves. That's what I think. And we will not fight for regime change in Russia. But it is very possible that it will happen. Because if you will take history, Russia is the last colonial empire in Europe. It is the last. And all colonial empires, when they are collapsing, when they are losing colonial wars, when they are losing imperialistic wars. And that's what Russia is moving forward to. So after this, it is absolutely possible that there will be some revolutions in Russia. That, by the way, will be also not easy story, because that will cause a lot of new challenges. Who will control mass destruction weaponry in Russia? What will go on in this huge territory? And so on. That can be a bloodshed there. Like 100 years ago, when Russian Empire collapsed, there was a bloodshed for years on this territory. It's a not easy story. But for us, it will be another story. Story of war of Russia against Ukraine should be finished very clearly. Russia just should be kicked off from Ukraine.
Thank you. I just want to give a quick reminder before asking the question. Can a member of the audience please introduce themselves with their name and class year if possible? Thank you.
Again, excellent auditoria and excellent, today you have excellent questions. So how it happened? I have two kids. One is 16 years old, two, another 4 years old. So this one who is 16 years old, he should attend school. Definitely as a father, I'm very concerned. He is not. but I am very concerned because first 2 years of COVID, it's online education, and it feels for me that it's not so good like normal. Now 1 year of war, part of it was just online education. From September 1, part of schools restarted, but every time they hear this sound, they should stop and go to shelters. And these sounds we have, unfortunately, quite often. And it means that it's not the best way. So definitely, I feel that my son and children, teenagers of his age all around, they really lost a lot of in their education. That's why I started this network of centers I told you. That was one of ideas how we can fill the gap which happened because of COVID. Now it's even worse. So that is a very big challenge for us. And definitely millions of Ukrainian children now are in Europe as the externally displaced people. We don't like to call them refugees, because also there are people here in the United States. We don't like to call them refugees because they want to come back home. But for the moment, they can't, because part of their cities are occupied or their houses are destroyed and their schools also. So they learn there. But yes, that's something which is a challenge for us. We're trying to do our best to fill these gaps, but it's quite difficult. Yeah, please.
Thank you. I'm a visiting professor from Ukraine, Poloniec. Mr. Goncharenko, thank you so much for your passionate lecture. As a Ukrainian citizen, I'm truly interested in your opinion as a parliament member. What do you think about the fight with corruption in Ukraine? Is it timely or untimely?
Oh, it is the most timely. First of all, like I also need to say this, because I think it was President Trump who said that, oh, Ukraine is the most corrupted country in the world, and it's not true, first of all. And it's not because I'm saying this in a member of parliament, but you can see it was one slide that I showed to you, that with the investments to Ukrainian army, much smaller than Russian, this is the scale of corruption. Do we have corruption in Ukraine? Yes. Is there corruption in the United States? Yes, also. Unfortunately, there is no place in the world without corruption at all. But the question is the country fighting with this corruption? Or tolerating it? And the second question is, what is the scale of this corruption? So you can see by comparing Ukrainian army and Russian army, by Ukrainian uniform and Russian uniform, but by how Ukrainian soldiers are fed and Russian soldiers are fed, you can see the difference. Russia is a very corrupted country. Ukraine is just a corrupted country. But we definitely need to do everything we can to make us less and less corrupted from day to day. And we are doing it from 2014. We have these dynamics. So we are much better now than we were 10 years ago. That's why it's one of the reasons why Putin attacked. Because it was clear for him that if he will not stop us now, in several years, there will be so big difference between Ukraine and Russia that even Russian people will start to ask questions. Why? What's going on? So that's why we need to fight corruption. It is absolutely in time question. We are doing this. And for this, there is no better way to fight corruption than these values that we were speaking about. Free media is great immunity system. Democracy, when people can change the government if they don't believe them, is the only way, and so on. So Ukraine is on the right track, and we will continue to do our best. Corruption is a real evil which should be fought all the time. Yeah, please.
Yes, my name is Josh Paul. I'm 26 from Westport, Connecticut. A few years ago, obviously we had assault on our capital, where we almost lost our democracy. We just had very close elections with election deniers almost won. And even we have people in our House of Representatives who don't accept the results of elections, who don't support the questions we give. The state of our democracy, I think, is still very fragile. What would your message be to Americans in this critical two-year period going into the next election about what the meaning of democracy is, what we should do to fight for it, and what we should do as college students to promote these values that that most Americans hold very dear to us?
Thank you for your question. I will definitely will not give any my personal thoughts, because I've been a Ukrainian politician. I have no right to intervene into American politics. So I will just tell you next that you're absolutely right in what you said, that democracy is nothing you just can inherit. Democracy exists because each new generation believes in it, and if needed, fights for it. The moment the next generation will say, we don't care, this exactly moment there will be people like Putin who will say, finally, I'm here. I will be your eternal president. You don't need anybody but me. And you don't need to care about anything. Don't think about anything. I'm your God. I'm your leader. I'm your Messiah. And that's why just be very attentive to these signals. Just remember this. And also remember that the process of losing of democracy is not just the one morning you are waking up and there is no democracy. Yesterday it was, today not. It's not like this. It's a process. And if you feel that media are influenced, that they are not really free, that the government doesn't want to change, and if something after results of election or anything else, that is a signal that you should react. Fortunately, I don't think there are so big threats in the United States that you need, like in Ukraine, we were on the streets several times making revolutions. Fortunately, you don't need this. You just need to go to vote and to be active citizen. I think that is absolutely enough to secure your democracy because you have healthy system, but it will be healthy as long as you will fight for it.
Thank you. Energy with us and coming to Dartmouth and New Hampshire. The question I have to you, you have mentioned that you have volunteer centers that are helping Ukraine in the multiple cities. So the question I have, with everything going on and the heavy load that volunteers are carrying in Ukraine, what are their concerns right now? Because one can do only that much in 24 hours. People probably are having work, side job, family, everything, and on top of everything else, they're helping communities, they're helping others, they're trying to make the country better. and trying to fight for the victory. So what the volunteers need right now, Ukraine? What do the volunteers themselves need, the people who carry this load of doing good?
First of all, I could start with money, but I will not. Because the most important thing for us is to have hope. That is something which is the engine of volunteers, of people. We need to know that there is a light in the end of the tunnel. And we know this for sure in Ukraine. That's why we are doing everything we can to make it closer. Why I'm here today? My family is in Odessa, like in the thousands and thousands of miles from here. And every time I have this application with air signals and I hear it, you understand what I think and how I feel. But I think it's so important to be in the United States because United States is the leader of the free world, the most powerful country from all points of view in the free world and in general because of these values that we spoke about. And for us, the support from the United States is vital. So what we need to know that the first thing the Ukrainian volunteers, Ukrainian civil society needs, it is to know that we are backed by the free world, that free world is behind us and is supporting us. And the United States is country number one in this. Secondly, definitely we need resources because you can't do anything without anything. So you need, people are coming to our centers to make masking nets, camouflage, for our army. And they're doing it certainly free of charge. They just want to do something to make their input. But other people are taking their old clothes, which is cut in pieces, to make this camouflage. But in any way, we need the basis. It's a kind of tissue that we need to buy. Without it, you can't make this masking net. So these bases we need. And probably this, and really everybody can. In our, for example, centers, there are a lot of, once again, that's not something unique. In Ukraine, there are a lot of such centers. There are a lot of such initiatives. But for example, in our center, one of our contributors is Lord Ashcroft, member of House of Lords of the United Kingdom, for example, and so on. So it is important to know, and it's also important morally that he is with us, but also financially. So that's what we need. Please. Yeah, please. Everybody at 26. There was some kind of a requirement to come here to be 26.
The 26 class loves Ukraine the most of all.
Yeah.
what you said really resonated with me was when you talk about kind of the global state of solidarity with Ukraine and about how the free world really needs to back against injustice everywhere and needs to support all injustices. Outside in the bigger picture, but with what you mentioned going on in China with the Uyghurs and Taiwan. And with other, occupations elsewhere, like occupation of Palestine and all the other injustices in the world, how does the Ukrainian government have plans after the war to kind of support other groups going under similar struggles and occupations?
Wow, great question. That's something which are debating in the country, and I believe that what is the future of Ukraine? I believe that after what we came through and coming through now. We can't be the same country we were before. We can't just kick off Russians and say, okay, we can be a better country, less corrupted, but no. I think the role of Ukraine for decades ahead will be to be one of the strongholds of the free world, one of the frontline units of free world. We will have very strong army. Why our army is so strong? I think today it's the second strongest army in the free world after the United States because of the battle experience that hundreds of thousands of our people have today, unfortunately. Unfortunately, but they have. And that makes our army so strong. And that's why I am one of those who are saying in the country, we should be the key ally of the United States and free world in the region. And we can't, there was something which I was disappointed by in the decision of our government. There was a voting in the United Nations about possible genocide of Uyghurs, and Ukraine abstained.
in the United Nations. And they will say, you know, it's China, it's a very big country, still there, a little bit like neutral, maybe more positive to Russia, but not very much. We should be patient and so on. And I was telling, this is a mistake. We can't address to people saying, please recognize genocide of Ukrainians, and there is genocide, Russians are making genocide. That is not, I am not telling you my political some estimations. That is a fact, because if you will take United Nations Charter on Prevention of Genocide, there are five criteria. If even one criteria is met, it's already genocide. It is a public announcement that this group does not exist. This group, religious group, an ethnic group, any group. And that's what Putin says. He is saying, Ukrainians, they don't exist. There are Russians, and they are bad Russians. There are no Ukrainians. Russia is saying, what we need to do? We need to de-Ukrainize Ukraine. This is a clear genocide. Second thing is forceful deportation of people, and we have it, especially children. They are taking our children from orphanages, and even with parents, and sending them to Russia, and giving them to some families throughout the whole country, from Far East, from Siberia, even there, just to make from Ukrainians Russians. That's what they want. And that is one more criteria of what is genocide. A lot of sexual crimes, rapings, that is exactly criteria of what is genocide. And certainly mass murders, unfortunately also we have this. So this is a genocide, but we can't say, the world, you should stop the genocide of Ukrainians, and at the same time, genocide of Uyghurs. Where are they? Oh, it's so far away from us. We can't do like this. We should be, absolutely, we should be the best defenders of these values in the world. That I believe, and many people in Ukraine think so, and I'm sure that Ukraine will be like the most, because for us it is very painful. We came through this. We understand better people in such circumstances than people in some normal countries with a normal life. That's why we should be very, very attentive to this and protect everybody we can. Yeah, please.
Hi, my name is Kyle. I'm a 22, so I guess I'm a
little bit
on the other chair. My question for you is, do you hope that after the war, maybe hopefully after Ukraine retakes, the Donbass retakes Crimea, that Ukraine will then go on to join the European Union, will go on to join NATO?
Absolutely.
Are these both organizations that you're hoping?
Yeah, that is definitely our way. We already became candidate to European Union. And I believe that, and today, just NATO, I was on the NATO summit in Madrid last June. You know, and I want to tell you, that was historical. It was really how the free world was united. And that was very inspiring, because for the first time in history, Prime Minister of Japan came to NATO summit. Australia, South Korea, other countries, and definitely Korea. I think that should be this process of expanding a free world. It started after this war, and that is so important. So definitely Ukraine should become member of European Union and NATO, and also our neighbors, Georgia, Moldova, other countries which are still not, they should also become members. We should unite. You can't just stay. Either you will expand or you will shrink. That's about free world. So we should expand free world, not only about Ukraine, but about other countries too. Yeah, please.
My name is Nadia, I'm 25. Thank you very much for being here today.
Thank you.
Touching on the topic of human rights, I know that in your intro video you mentioned the potential of a Nuremberg-type kind of war crimes tribunal. I wanted to ask you kind of what that looks like right now in Ukraine. Are there ongoing preparations or serious documentation processes for things like sexual violence or other war crimes? And yeah, is the government already kind of preparing for something like that to happen after war?
Yeah, definitely. That it is, first of all, for us, it's justice. Justice to people after everything they came through. Secondly, and that is already important for everything in this room, is to prevent such things to happen. Because the only thing to prevent new crime to happen is to prosecute the crime which already happened. So that is the same in the international law, and we should do this. And as you maybe remember in this introduction video, I said, and after New Nuremberg, there should be tribunal against Russian war crime people who did it, including Putin himself. That is very important. And we are collecting evidences. We are doing a lot of job in this direction. I just came here from Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, where we made a resolution on an international tribunal. And we want to establish it as quickly as possible. Just special, first of all, special tribunal about the main, the mother of all war crimes, crime of aggression, which should be leadership of Russia, should be, and Belarus should be punished for this. But definitely we are also, there are already convicted people in Ukraine, Russian soldiers and officers who killed, who raped, and we will continue to do this. And I think it's something which you remember, you know from history, that some Nazi criminals were found when you were already alive, when you already lived. I mean, just 20 years ago, for example, in some Argentina, in the people in their 90s, some German Nazi criminals, they were found and prosecuted. I think that's the only way. Because it every, let it better quicker. But if it will take decades, we need to finish this job. We need to find everybody. And that will make the world better. Please. Yeah, it's like two questions. First, I'm not a military expert. This thing, you can't estimate exactly. I needed to have some number, like 3% of budget, which is clear. You can just divide. And 50% definitely it's not an exact number. But military experts are saying that, taking into consideration that Black Sea Russian fleet is almost destroyed, taking into consideration thousands of Russian tanks, armored vehicles and other stuff which is destroyed, we can roughly estimate that this is near half of a Russian conventional war. That is important because also there is a nuclear weaponry, but conventional war potential. So definitely it's roughly and it's more expert at, estimation, but I think it's quite close. But the second question, you're absolutely right. As I told you, for dictators, people is a fuel of their dictatorships. And that's what we see in Russia now today. He is conscripting people all the time. They hadn't stopped mobilization. It's on the way in Russia. And by this, Putin thinks that he can, even in such bad circumstances, even after his initial plans failed, even after all this level of corruption, which I think even he couldn't imagine, and so on. But even after all of this, he still believes that he can achieve some of his goals. By what? By these people. By sending hundreds of thousands of people to die, but to keep the position. And this is the threat. That is the threat, because this war has not finished. That's something which I am telling to my colleagues. And that is so frustrating, because these decisions about weaponry supply to Ukraine were so, so slow. And all of them so protracted that this gave possibility for Putin to come to this war of attrition. Why I can tell you this too. When the war started, I joined territorial defense to defend Kiev. I was in Kiev. I never had military experience. And I hope that I will never have again. But there was no, I couldn't run away from Kiev as MP, but there was also not much place for me as a parliamentarian to do when Russian army was 30 kilometers from my building of the parliament. And that's why for the first month I was in territorial defense. So I took Kalashnikov in my hands. In 1 month, when Russians were kicked off from Kiev, I finally could take back my selfie stick, because I'm much better with my selfie stick than with my Kalashnikov, and do what I really can do. But I, being in territorial defense, I can tell you that if Ukrainian army would have in March of last year weaponry that we received in May, June, HIMARSes, howitzers, and other things, we would finish everything in April when Russians were retreating, but we didn't have with what to purchase them. And that gave Putin possibility to refresh a little, replenish, change plans, to mobilize, to send this new cannon fodder to the front line. And that was a big mistake. And all the time, unfortunately, it looks like the free world is like chasing after Putin. Putin is sending more people. Okay, we will give you more howitzers. More people, okay, we're giving you tanks. It's very frustrating about patriots, because like it was clear from the first, from summer, that Putin will weaponize winter, that he will attack power grid, that he will destroy this in order to make people suffer, and that we needed at that time air defense. But still our allies made this decision only in January. And it means that we will receive patriots maybe in April, maybe we still don't have them. And that's why Russia is still quite successful in their attacks against our infrastructure. So that's the problem. Everything could be finished quicker, and that would be in benefit of the whole world. But still, it takes a lot of time. So, yeah.
Please.
Hi, I'm Eric from a 23. I was thinking, many of our international organizations were created to prevent wars of territorial conquest and genocide. And in spite of that, we've had multiple genocides, and now we have a war of conquest. Do you think at the end of this war, we should build upon our existing international system of like the UN and such, or should we form new systems?
Absolutely. That new or modernize these, definitely. First of all, Russia should be kicked off from Security Council. And by the way, those from you who study politics or law, I can tell you that it's very easy quest for you, very easy thing to make in your decision. Because Russia, if you will take Charter of United Nations, you will not find Russia there. If you will take who are the members of Security Council, permanent members of Security Council, you will not find Russia. And even more, Russian Federation never entered United Nations. Ukraine entered, Belarus entered, many other countries, yes, Russia never. So what they're doing in Security Council, it's a very interesting question. So definitely, that we have very big gaps in this international law, in all these systems, in international security systems, and we will definitely need a very big reforming, very big reforming. But good thing I will tell you, 100 years ago, many nations didn't care about genocide at all. Now, we have, yes, unfortunately, we still have these things, and especially unfortunately for me in my own country, but it's much less than it was. So we're on the right track. We need to establish, to continue, to defend international law, and step by step, we will build a real world in which, like, the person, the human being, will be the biggest value.
So we're coming closer to the end. I don't know if someone wants to ask the last question, but after this, we will have like about like half an hour for those people who want to stay and get to know Mr. Goncharenko on a more personal level. And then we still have some cookies you're welcome to take. But if anyone wants to ask the last question, or if not, I have a question I would ask.
I'm Kareva, I'm 26. I wanted to ask you a question about the Ukrainian parliament. Because right now Ukraine is under martial law. It requires a lot of executive decision from the president, from the army. And it might seem that the discourse is a bit downplayed right now. So what's the role of the parliament today?
I can tell you that you know, Russia was for years saying that in Russian propaganda that Ukraine is a failed state. At this stage, in reality, they don't exist there. But it happened that it is Russia, failed empire. Because Ukraine showed that our institutes are alive. Our parliament was gathering in the building of the parliament when Russians were 30 kilometers from our building. It's very close. It's a artillery shelling distance. And not even missiles or something like this. And we are a country with the rule of law. All what's happening in Ukraine is according to our constitution. We are changing the laws. Yes, definitely our juridical system was not prepared for such a full-scale war. So now we need to make a lot of changes in the law. We need to think about people who are externally displaced. Now, for example, the last thing we made, that people, Ukrainians, can marry outside of Ukraine. Like, for example, that's a question. Before it was not a question for us, because like, now we have this question, because millions of people are outside. So we are doing our job, parliament is working, laws are adopted in the right way. I want even more. I think that parliament can play a bigger role and can more oversee what's going on, more doing our job in fighting corruption and other things. But I should be, I can be proud of Ukrainian parliament. It works. And yeah, there were also MPs who ran away from the country. There were several who betrayed the country and they started to work for Russia. Unfortunately, these were people like this too. But they, that was a tiny, tiny number comparing to the parliament which united in order to defend the country. So I think that's important. And very good question. Thank you, Kirilo.
Thank you so much for these amazing questions. I wanted to ask one question. So Mr. Goncharenko has this really heroic story of hoisting a Ukrainian flag on the highest point of Crimea, Mount Ipetri.
Yeah.
So can you share what you were feeling and can you share a little bit more about that story?
Thank you. Yeah, it was, as I told you, in 2014, Russia occupied part of Ukraine, which is Crimea. At that time, I was president of Odessa Regional Council. It's like president of New Hampshire Senate, something like this. And on August 23, which is a national flag of Ukraine Day, my job was to raise our flag near the building of Odessa Regional Council. But I thought that it was more important to go to Crimea, and that at that time it was still possible. So I entered Crimea. I came to one of the most famous places in Crimea, which is Mount Ipetri, over a very beautiful place. When you will come to Ukraine, you should welcome to Odessa and to Crimea separately, but that's very beautiful. And I raised Ukrainian flag there, saying that this is Ukraine. And that was a very mixed feeling because it was a feeling that I'm in Crimea, which is Ukraine, and now it is stolen from Ukraine. And that was painful. But on another hand, it was a great proud that they can steal it for some time, but in the end of the day, ours will be ours. So that was how it was, and that was important for me to do this.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.